Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the CEO of the Churchill Club, Karen Tucker.
Hello there, and welcome to our program. My name is Karen Tucker, and I'm CEO and a board member at the Churchill Club, and tonight's program is called A Talent for Talent. And those of us in the room tonight are in for a treat. We have with us Ari Emanuel of William Morris Endeavor Entertainment and Jeff Weiner of LinkedIn in conversation with Kara Swisher of All Things D. Before we invite our distinguished speakers and moderator to the stage, I want to acknowledge our program sponsors. They are Hill and Knowlton and Wharton University of Pennsylvania, San Francisco. Greatly appreciate their support, so please join me in thanking our two generous sponsors. And I also want to especially thank Shannon Stubo of LinkedIn for her amazing help in bringing this program into being. Couple of brief announcements, if I may. On Wednesday, July 27, we present a breakfast program called Information Overload 2.0 with Jonathan Spira of BaseX and Derek Dean of the Exeter Group in conversation with Dave Needle. And then on August 3rd, we present Inside Google's Search Office, an evening with three of the key people there. And they're going to be in conversation with Danny Sullivan of Search Engine Land. Couple of dates to save if you can. The evening of September 15, we present the first annual Churchill Club Awards to acknowledge exemplary achievements in the areas of innovation, social benefit, collaboration, and mentorship, four essential ingredients in our innovation ecosystem in Silicon Valley or any innovation ecosystem around the globe. And on September 16, it's a day-long conference called Igniting Innovation and Mastering Change. Both of these two outstanding events are presented on the occasion of our 25th anniversary celebration year. You'll find Twitter codes in your printed program, and if you're tweeting, please do use # Churchill Club. And my final announcement, tonight's program is being live streamed on fora.tv and will be available on demand after tonight. So please pass that information along to your followers so that they can access the program as well. It's now my pleasure to bring up Mr. Steve Bengston, Chairman of the Board at the Churchill Club and Managing Director of Emerging Company Services at PwC.
Thanks, Karen. I'm thrilled to introduce our speakers tonight. Ari Emanuel is co-CEO and Director of William Morris Endeavor Entertainment Agency, one of the world's top global talent agencies. He represents such diverse clients as Michael Moore, Martin Scorsese, World Wrestling Entertainment, Michael Douglas, Charlize Theron, and Mark Wahlberg. Ari is also co-founder of the Rain Group, a boutique bank whose private equity fund investors include Facebook founding President Sean Parker and former Google CEO Eric Schmidt. Ari's been ranked number 4 on the Entertainment Weekly Smartest People in Hollywood list and also serves as the basis for the character Ari Gold on HBO's hit series Entourage. Jeff Weiner is the CEO of LinkedIn, a company you may have heard of lately. The web's largest network of professionals has become a top resource for companies to connect with the talent pool in virtually every industry around the world. Under Jeff's watch, LinkedIn's membership has increased from 33 million to over 100 million members. How many people here are a member of LinkedIn? High percentage of the population. LinkedIn's hiring solutions are used by 73 of the Fortune 100 companies. I wonder who wouldn't use them. And its site is presently adding more than one member every second. 1,002. Two new members tonight. Jeff's a graduate of the Wharton School at the University of Pennsylvania, who by sheer coincidence is one of our sponsors tonight. Our moderator, Kara Swisher, writes the popular Boomtown blog, All Things Digital website, allthingsd.com, which she runs with Walt Mossberg. Together they produce the unique and influential annual technology conference, All Things Digital. Kara is also the author of two books about AOL. Please welcome Ari Emanuel, Jeff Weiner, and Kara Swisher.
You're in the middle. No, you're in the middle. No, then I don't have to. No. Yeah. Hey, who's in charge here? I know.
All right,
I know you can boss around those celebrities in Hollywood, but up here.
I wish.
Yeah. So I just tweeted. I was really glad to be up here with Crockett and Stubbs. Stubbs, that's a better name for you. So we're going to talk tonight about a lot of things. These guys are incredibly entertaining and a lot of fun to talk about various things that are going on. But I just want to start. I really hope you get back together with Mrs. Ari on this season. I'm really upset about it.
Well, I'm really sad, actually, it's the last season.
I know.
Actually, after this, tomorrow I'm flying in for the premiere in New York.
Uh-huh.
And then hopefully after this season, they can get the movie done, which...
Now, are you representing everybody in this?
I represent Doug Allen. I represent Mark Wahlberg. I represent Steve Levinson. And we represent some of the other actors. But, you know, that's just, enough, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So you not only star in the thing, you also make all the money from it. Okay, so we're going to talk, the talent is, the thing is about talent as a brand. So let's start talking about that idea. It was unusual to put you two together, so I want to understand, what was, Jeff, you organized this. Why bring together you and Ari? It's kind of LinkedIn and Hollywood.
Why, Jeff?
it's actually pretty straightforward. So I guess the Churchill Club reached out to Shannon, did an amazing job helping to organize this, and we were talking a little bit about ideas, and I said, well, what are some examples of previous events? And she said, Eric Schmidt interviewed James Cameron, and Reed Hastings was up here with Michael Eisner. And so it sounded like a good combination of Silicon Valley and Hollywood made for an interesting event. And we're, to some extent, very largely focused on talent, mm-hmm. connecting talent with opportunity at scale. And Ari is about as good as they get when it comes to the world of talent. And then also remembered last year at Web 2.0, John Battelle had hosted Ari for dinner. And when I did the event the next day, he actually referred back to it as I was describing a little bit about what LinkedIn does. So that was how we got Ari. And then we were thinking about a moderator. And
well,
of course,
and
ended up with you.
Mean, you're
right,
the best.
Right. And I had to stop doing my phone hacking just for tonight.
Whoa.
No, I had to. Come on.
Yeah, you had to go.
We're a News Corp company. We're so proud this week.
Are you proud?
No, not in the least. But I have to say, I've gotten from every internet mogul, now I've gotten emails, starting with Jerry Yang, your old boss. Now I know how you get all your scoops, which I know. I was like, thank you. Nice shot. And I thought, no. It's all.
So what do you think is going to happen tomorrow?
That's a good question. Rupert is and James or Murdoch are going to testify. Mm. It could be a disaster. It could be a giant British twit fest. Who knows what's going to happen there? I don't know. But not pretty. Not pretty, I think. Pretty
That's
much.
Part of the cost of that is that people who had nothing to do with it actually
right.
take a huge hit.
Yep, you know, talking
the
about
innocent, brand. Innocent journalists, innocent people getting their phones hacked.
Well, I'm not really innocent, but yes, in this case, yes, it's true. But let's talk about talent as a brand. Let's talk about moving. Anyway, I do not phone hack, and I don't know how to, although I'd love to know how they did it. Let's talk about the idea of what brand is now today. So why don't you start, Ari, because things have, I mean, brand was something that you knew, that you guys knew well in Hollywood and how to build it. So how do you look at a brand today, and what does it mean in Hollywood?
Well, let me go back a little bit. So actually, one of the reasons I started Endeavor is in 1991, when I was at ICM, I brought, and I've said this on occasion, I brought George Gilder out to speak at ICM. Mm-hmm. And at the time, I think it was in 1990, maybe late in the late 80s, he wrote a book, Life After Television.
Yep.
And in that, you know, you started talking about 10,000 channels and infinite distribution and that, you know, there'd be more need for content and people that create content, and they would be the asset, not distribution. And that got me thinking after reading that, and he came to speak. And I said to myself, you know something, I think that's right. There was big rumors about two more networks starting in Hollywood. I was at the time I'd been an agent actually before we started Endeavor for 4 years, mm-hmm. and I had a pretty good television business. And I said, you know something, let's just go for it, see what happens. I believe if we can build a brand and our clients into brands, they're going to be more valuable over time. We started the agency, the WB started, and UPN started at the time. And in 1995, pricing for writers, which is the core of the television business, and we started as a television agency with a little bit motion picture, Fox put up $120 million for overall deals for writers to kind of, like the old Hollywood system, collect a bunch of writers to create for television, because there was now six places that was creating television. There was really no cable at the time. And Disney put up the same amount of money. So within 2 months of us opening up the agency, we had covered our nut. Then, you know, as we progressed, cable exploded. It just kept on going. And we now see where distribution is in the entertainment business. One of the reasons we did the merger was we thought we needed more areas of people creating content, and that there was going to be more need for content in multiple distribution areas. And actually, one of the ways we met, we were talking about an author that we represented that wrote on business, possibly creating content for LinkedIn, right? And to think that would be a conversation in, you know, Southern California, that this would be a conversation that we would be having as content for them, was kind of bizarre.
So
right?
The idea is that the talent is important, not the distribution.
He has distribution.
Right.
He has an audience. I have a client writing about business philosophy and business techniques, and that was a good thing for him. And to kind of put those things together, it was actually after we had our first time I really met you through Lloyd, and he started talking about the business, and we started talking about this concept of maybe we could create some content for his audience. Cut to, you know, we do the merger, so we have authors now, we have music, we have books, we have theater, we have a bunch of other things. And we have four pieces to our business. We have the investment group. We're building a marketing group, which also we've introduced to LinkedIn. We're not doing something, but... And then we have what I would define as a digital strategy. And that's the kind of four legs of our stool. The guys that invest in media, we have offices here in Silicon Valley. So we get insight in kind of what traditional media is doing, what kind of people up in Silicon Valley do. We have offices in Beijing in that area, so we get a bunch of insight for the agency there. The agency is, you know, it does the normal, you know, TV shows, movies, we're pretty good at that stuff, and music and books. And that's really the engine that enables everything else. And then we licensed our social area. We licensed we created a business opportunity with a gentleman by the name of Oliver Luckett, who left Disney, who had created this company called DigiSend. He created this company called The Audience. We gave him a license that we're working with him. And we thought about, from the day we merged, that you know, our clients touch about, we thought, 200 million people on the social graph. Well, it turns out we touch about a billion, too.
And about half of that's Kim Kardashian.
Right. And
don't laugh. That girl is smart as
And we now have just finished the first, Oliver's finished the first beta test with 50 clients. We're at about 200 million people on Facebook. And we're now, he's going
to
be building this.
Start to be doing. It's a critical part of building stars.
Yeah, and then you're now going to be, we're going to be, hopefully, knock wood, if we can figure out what the formula is, building channels with Google. And then we're going to be building a marketing business that folds into that and other initiatives we have.
So, Jeff,
so that's our business.
So Jeff, when you think about this idea, you started off in Hollywood, correct? You had a career, you would work with Terry Semel and some others and some entertainment business a little bit. How do you look at this shift in Hollywood? Because initially Hollywood was very reticent to be involved with, I mean, do you think of yourself as a content distributor?
That's certainly part of it.
Finder.
I think it's multifaceted for LinkedIn. We think of ourselves first and foremost as a platform, and we're trying to create as much value as we can for the membership. And so going back to the original point, the original question on talent as a brand, you know, the cornerstone of our offering is the profile. And the profile enables every professional anywhere in the world to essentially create their own brand by completing the profile and being able to express their experiences, their skills, I think most importantly, people's ambitions. And once that profile is complete, as long as it's relevant and up to date, it's going to get search engine optimized, which means when people do a search for you or people like you with your skill sets on, say, Google or Bing or Yahoo, your profile is going to show up at or near the top of the results. And in an age where search has that kind of value, that's an incredibly powerful dynamic. And there's a very virtuous cycle that takes root there, because the more opportunities that accrue to you as a result of that, the more people begin to engage with LinkedIn. And the reason they're completing their profiles, unlike, say, a resume that you update only when you're looking for work, is because they know opportunity will come their way. They know that they're in a better position to stay in touch with former colleagues, current colleagues, business contacts, and the value that accrues to them as a result, the sharing of information, the sharing of knowledge, of ideas, best demonstrated practices, business intelligence, competitive intelligence. And so, in a sense, that's all content. Mm-hmm. And so the content that is rooted within this platform will ultimately create value for people who are willing to share their identity and build out their networks and, in a sense, build their professional brand.
So when you're saying it's content, what kind of content would you call it? It's information about someone. It's their, you know, remember that old
brand? Yeah, but, you know, you're defining content the way...
I'm wondering how you...
Yeah, you're defining content as, I think, and I don't want to put, I definitely don't want to put words in your mouth, but you're defining content as a TV show, a book,
right.
What we would consider traditional content.
Right.
Right? And I believe that that is content. But that is what he's defining also as content. It's just for its platform content, right? As for my son, Noah, which I say to people, you know, things he pulls up and shows me that he thinks is funny is a form of content for his generation on YouTube,
right.
And that's content,
right?
For them.
Right. I do want to talk about the changing idea, because your business is rooted in a very organized set of content.
Sometimes.
Or it's content that people have been well known. But what I want to get to with Jeff is, like, what is that content to you? What do you think it is?
I think it's all content. I think a profile is content. I think a status update is content. Certainly when you share a news headline that you believe is interesting, that is ultimately content, not just the link itself, but obviously the news article.
That's stealing.
The discussions taking place. Notice how I didn't bite there, yeah. The discussions taking place within groups is content, clearly. It's all content. Anything that can help create value, anything that is a mechanism through which people can better learn, can better communicate, all of that stuff becomes content. In Ari's world, historically, it was the way in which people used discretionary time to become entertained. In your world, it's the way people are informed. In our world, it's the way people become more productive and more successful. I think at the end of the day, it comes back to context. It's always about context.
Context. Right, within your situation. So when you have an author coming to LinkedIn, like he brings an author to you, which is a very traditional...
Every idea I brought, he's rejected. I'm going to keep on trying.
Okay.
No, for the record, not true. I think he's got amazing ideas.
Exactly, too, because a lot of people talk about Facebook, you all becoming content distributors, like you becoming a very powerful way for people to find out about traditional content, all kinds of content. Do you see that that is your role, or just because
we're a platform? We enable value to accrue to our membership in any way that enables our membership to become more productive and successful. So if you are trying
to... I assume also that you want to become more sticky, that they spend more time.
Yeah, but at the end of the day, we're not about passing time. We're about enabling people to save time. So it's not necessarily a mechanism. That's not an ultimate objective for us, is to get people spending as much time as possible. I think more engagement is better than less, because it's a proxy for value creation, the fact that we're delivering a relevant experience for the end user.
Right, but you don't see yourself as using, like, say you could have all the Tony Robbins lectures, all the...
It may not be Tony Robbins, but when Ari first came up, we were talking about the importance of leadership. And that's what he was referring to earlier, and I thought it was a fantastic fit and a fantastic idea. It wasn't about the content, it was about the business model. That's a whole different story, which is the way in which these platforms are fundamentally transforming the way value is extracted explicitly. Not implicitly for the member, but how the intellectual property owner of a leadership series would extract value from our platform. And that's where things got interesting. It wasn't about whether or not there was a great fit for our platform and his content. That's an absolute no-brainer. As a matter of fact, stick the two of us in a room with a whiteboard, we'll fill it with ideas in which we can create value for our membership and value for his clients. The question is, what's the business model surrounding this stuff? Do you want it to be closed, highly proprietary, and in theory, highly economic to the intellectual property holder, or do you want it to be massively open?
I would
open,
say yes.
Or do you want it to be massively open and viral, where the economic value added may not be as explicit, but you can build enormous brands, you can build enormous audiences that can later be monetized through other mechanisms. And these are some of the discussions that
What
you
was
and
the
have.
Phrase you used? Free, no, I'm not trying to be,
I'm not trying to be Ari
Gold here. You know, there was a phrase that he used about giving it away for free for a period of time. And
freemium?
Freemium, yeah. Right, freemium. The freemium. And, you know, that's a very hard concept for Southern California,
yes,
I think.
Yes, it is, yeah.
You know?
we'll
because a lot of freemiums have sprouted very big businesses here.
Right,
right.
Right.
And I do believe that the more distribution, the more people see it, there is some long tail to it.
Right.
I just can't figure out if that's going to pay for the kids' college.
Right, right. But that's an interesting concept, because the idea is that, you know, there's a lot of these streaming services that do well up here for themselves, but not for you.
Yeah.
So we've had that discussion before, the idea
yes,
of
where,
who has the power in this relationship. How do you look at that now in the changing when you
well,
think
about
it?
Well, first of all, I'm glad that it wasn't it's not a complete, and I've been talking about this at a lot of these 2.0s, this kind of European three-strike rule, right? Mm-hmm. And we've now implemented here because I think not because they really care about the content. I think the people kind of downloading things and stealing things have been clogging up the system and costing them money, and they realize the network has been affected by it, so therefore it's in their best interest to kind of start restricting this. And I had this fight with Barry Dilleron in one panel at the Milken conference where he said, well, how could you find out? Well, if you can find out when people are doing pornography or other things, you can find out when somebody's stealing a piece of content. There's got to be a way that we can coexist where we believe that people up here can make money on their platforms or, you know, sell hardware, but also we make a living, right? Now, is Jeff Bukas right about his model, right, which he's trying to implement? I'm not sure, but I think there's too many smart people in the room for us not to figure out, because eventually, with all this distribution, they become less important without great content. But if we can't pay for the content, then you're not going to have anything to put up on your system.
But Jeff's talking about a different kind of content that isn't it's interesting.
Well, no, but
in
when
and
he's
itself.
Talking about putting our author
right.
on his
right.
system and giving it away for free, there's no way. We couldn't figure out, the monetization that kind of satisfied the author, right? Not that the concept wasn't the right concept, because it actually was. It was a whole leadership thing leading into conferences and et cetera. But I was talking more on other form, not his specific form of distribution.
But what was interesting, Karen, I think you'd find it interesting, and this is what the industry needs to really grapple with and ultimately successfully navigate. In this case, the author philosophically felt that what he had written and what he had created was worth something.
Right.
And could not get his arms around freemium. So right. It was never the intention to offer this for free in perpetuity. It was the intention to take a subcomponent of the overall archive to create a mechanism through which we could make that as viral as possible.
Interest.
And then get people yep. to pay for going much deeper with that content. Mm-hmm. But even the idea of giving a bit of it away for free,
it devalued
what he does.
So when you're dealing with talent in Hollywood, how do they look at it now? I mean, because they do like to get paid down there. That's sort of like, I always think of them, when I talk to Hollywood people, they're always like, can I get paid up front? And here it's a little different.
I think that's actually changing. I think the economics over the last couple of years have kind of, in the movie business and the television business, has kind of changed that relationship. I do believe that from how things were being monetized, or lack of monetization, or whatever you want to call it, to now there's a big kind of, people are getting closer to trying to figure out and work with each other and trying to figure that out. But I do believe there has to be some sort of economic exchange, one of ideas and then two of formulas, so that everybody gets the benefit of what their platforms and their content create.
So what do you think is promising? Is it just Netflix handing you a giant $100 million check to your clients and studios, or is it something else that's going to emerge? When you have a Hollywood star, a person who, whether it's a star or it's a book or something like that, how do you approach them?
That's your BlackBerry.
I don't have a BlackBerry.
I don't have one.
Either. No, I don't have one. Either.
That's somebody's.
No.
Okay.
Phone hacking.
Yeah.
Anyway.
That's Rupert. Yeah.
That's Rupert. It's back here. So how do you approach when you're presenting with all these various ways to do their career? How do you advise them now, besides just getting the movie, getting the show?
Well, it's different. When you're dealing with an actor, it's different. When you're dealing with a creator of a television show, it's different. When you're dealing with, you know, a company like the UFC, who we represent, or the WWE or Hasbro, that's why we created a company with four legs. Some clients, like Aaron Sorkin, he's got a show on HBO. All he cares about is writing that show. He's one of the greatest writers. He just wants to stay in the agency and do that. Some clients, like Hasbro and all these other, want to use all aspects of the agency. So for them, we're doing a fund for a film fund for them. We're doing stuff in digital with them. We're doing books with them. And then, you know, we're working with them on how to handle their cable channel and then deal with international. Same thing with USC. So some clients go wide and some clients just go deep in certain areas.
Do you want all your clients to go wider in the internet than the digital space or not? Or do you feel like...
I think all of them have to, because as... I'll give you a perfect example. Taylor Lautner. He's got this new movie coming out with Lionsgate, right? Mm-hmm. And they're going to put
up... This is the werewolf on Twilight, right?
Yeah. Yeah. They're going to... Well, not that movie, but another movie,
yeah.
Right? So they're gonna put up a website, and there's going to be 8,000 people that visit the website. But his social presence, I think there's about 15 million people on Facebook. At the time that he didn't think he was on Facebook. There was 350 sites that were... Taylor Lautner sites. Well,
right.
We condensed them. There's now approximately 15 million people. And now, when Lionsgate wants to get to his fans, they're going to pay Taylor Lautner to get to his fans, as opposed to putting up a website that just gets 8,000 people.
Right.
So it's important, as Taylor Lautner moves throughout his career, to control that conversation with his audience and with his fans so that he can have a conversation. We're starting, the audience, this company that we're talking about, is programming his social presence,
right.
And that he can take throughout his career, and there won't be kind of these peaks and valleys of the career. He can kind of have a steady stream, and whether his relationship with brands or whether his relationships with movies and television or whatever else he does in media, and that for us is an important tool that we're providing for our clients, for them as not only a marketing tool but also a conversation to constantly have with his audience, that he can constantly have that and get the message out that he wants it. And that's going to hopefully go across all of our clients.
So he owns his audience.
Correct.
Rather than the studio.
Correct.
Whatever.
And they can't get, they have no way to do that. The only
right.
way to do that is through him. And he doesn't know how to program it. I think we found the right group of people that do know how to program it. So, you know, right now, with only 40 of our clients, or 50 of our clients, we reach approximately 240 million people on Facebook.
Right.
Right? That's a nice little number, worth something, I think, for the clients. So that's how we're doing it.
Well, how do you decide that that's worth something? I mean, that he has 50 million people is one thing, but getting them to go to the movies and getting them...
I think over time we're going to find out now whether we can affect his movie business or television shows or his relationship with marketing companies. We're going to find out what the value is. I think it is pretty valuable.
And what do you do on those social networks now? Is it just like chest pictures of him? Because that's what I'm thinking of, chest pictures.
Really?
Yeah, it just was, for some reason, they're running Twilight on every cable show right now. Like,
well,
all
what,
of them.
You know something, it's programmed.
Nice chest.
Over the next 3 months, there's a program of how he will get the message out about the show and what he's doing.
I see.
We have programmed kind of his, almost, it's a magazine calendar of kind of what will come out on his Facebook page and other pages.
What he's going to do.
Yes.
So, Jeff, do you think you can create, you talk yourself about a platform a lot so that you don't care what happens on it, or do you think you create things on it, not just stars, but the idea of personalities? Do you see that as something LinkedIn doing? I mean, Facebook is sort of doing it by accident in many ways. So does YouTube, sort of just, it just happens. depending on what people do. How do you look at that idea? Do you create talent in that regard?
I guess in part, yeah. You know, the definition of a platform is really an enabling capability. So it's not so much by accident when someone becomes famous on a Facebook or YouTube, because that's really the intention of those platforms. Mm-hmm. The same could be said of Twitter and generating, you know, millions upon millions of followers. I think on LinkedIn, people do have that opportunity to showcase their knowledge about a particular subject matter, become the expert, and be able to communicate best demonstrated practices within a particular area. I think ultimately, it's really about how each individual member wants to create value out of the network. In listening to Ari, one thing is interesting to me is the fact that each of our individual professional members, to some extent, is replicating what you're doing with your talent, just on a much smaller scale. It's not right. about generating 15 million followers on a Facebook or a Twitter, and then signing up a movie deal and a television deal, et cetera.
If you have any, I want to represent them.
Okay. but it most definitely is about people being able to create more value by virtue of becoming connected with others, by virtue of becoming increasingly followed by others, by getting their brand out there, their experiences, their skill sets, their knowledge base. And in building those connections, creating opportunities. It's not dissimilar in any way, shape, or form. It's just much higher profile right. in Ari's world.
Right. And no chest pictures, except for some people. So what would that be? Like someone being selling themselves in video or doing, what do people use now? What are they in order to sell themselves? That's what you're talking about.
Well, within LinkedIn, it's not so much about explicitly selling yourself, although you certainly can. I'm reminded of the example of an entrepreneur in the Netherlands who, when the iPhone first came out, his battery kept running out, like a lot of folks. And he went on to a group within LinkedIn, and he started talking about whether or not other people were experiencing the same problems. And it turned out that he was clearly not alone. He found out from another group that there was a Chinese manufacturer that was starting to make add-ons that would provide additional battery life. And he connected with that company, and he started distributing that product, and started using his connections on LinkedIn to market the effort. So he essentially built a company. He wasn't selling himself, and he didn't start by selling anything, but he was able to identify an opportunity and then leverage his network to create value.
Yeah.
We hear stories like that all the time. A startup in Ireland, the founder needed to raise an angel fund, and so went on to LinkedIn, and I think he had targeted a few $100,000, and less than 2 weeks later, his entire network had provided him the funds. There was a student who had just graduated from film school. You'll want to represent her in New York, and she wrote me a thank you note. I had never met her to say she got financing for her first film soon after graduating as a result of her connections on LinkedIn. Not necessarily explicitly selling themselves, but it's the power of the network and the opportunities it creates where we see that kind of value being generated.
Mm-hmm. That's cool.
And in terms of, do you see yourself doing more of that? Doing more, is that what you're there for, or is it just continuing to create a platform for resumes and job finding?
It's hardly about resumes. It's most definitely about your identity, and I think it's not about your identity in and of itself. It's about your identity and what happens as a result of sharing your identity. As the web has evolved, I mean, I'm reminded of that cartoon in The New Yorker. It's really old. Back when the web first started to proliferate, it was on the internet, nobody knows you're a dog.
Oh, yeah.
And you could say that was the era of the portal. You know, companies mm-hmm. like Yahoo were organizing the world's information via the internet. And then along came Google and started indexing massive amounts of content. We went from the portal to the search engine. And now we've got these social platforms. And for these social platforms to work, they're anchored by identity. So now that same dog probably has a LinkedIn profile. He's wearing a tie, and he's looking for commercial gigs, and Ari's representing him or her, and he's on Twitter saying, who let the dogs out, whatever. That identity is at the core of the value that's being created through these social platforms, and the value prop goes well beyond that. It's about connecting with others. It's about building your networks, and it's ultimately about sharing. It's ultimately about sharing information, knowledge, information, ideas, opinions. It's about the way we work. It's about the way we play. It's about the way we learn. It's fundamentally about the way we live.
So how many of these can exist? Now we now have Google Plus now on top of Twitter, on top of LinkedIn, on top of Facebook, top of blank, blank. Not MySpace anymore. That's gone, thank you.
I think it's a great question, and I think, you know, I'm curious.
Do you think it's gone?
I don't know.
No.
Yeah.
Were you asking about MySpace?
Yeah. What do you think? You don't really care what I think. What do you think?
I don't know. I mean, you know, a client, Justin Timberlake, went into it.
It's kind of stunt casting.
I'm going to hear about what the vision is.
Right.
You know,
because he has all that free time to work on a porn. I used to cover all the celebrities going into the internet space, and so far it's 0 for 10.
You just mentioned part of the answer to your question,
yeah,
which was he has a lot of free time,
yeah,
and
he doesn't.
He doesn't facetious. Have free time. So I would venture to say no one in this audience today has a lot of free time.
Right.
And I think the short answer to your question of how many of these can we utilize is that not many more when it comes to these social platforms, because unlike, say, a social platform in television, which, as you know, coexists, and I'm sure the agency spends a lot of time trying to think about that interaction, you don't see a lot of people using Twitter while they're using Facebook or using Facebook while they're using LinkedIn.
Right.
And so I think the addition of Google Plus, if it continues the current momentum that it's generated, it makes what was, I think, a very understandable landscape. You use LinkedIn for your professional, relevant professional services, and Facebook for family and friends, and Twitter to microcast or broadcast. You introduce a Google Plus, and all of a sudden people start to say, okay, where am I going to spend that next minute or hour of my discretionary time? And at some point, we just don't have any more time. So we have to make choices.
So how do you look at it when you see all these? I mean, because Google Plus is really quite an amalgam of all them, of all of these things. I was going to make a joke in my column. You know,
I look at it as following. Right now, there's, you know, Facebook, Google Plus, you know, Foursquare. I mean, you can keep on going. Eventually, the good thing is, I look at it as to distinguish themselves, they're going to have something on them. That actually makes
people.
So
they have to come to you.
They have to come to me.
I see.
It all comes back to
Ari. And I'm actually,
over time,
you know, fucking A with leverage. I'm dangerous.
Right. Okay.
So I'm not sure if I'll be around.
Right.
I'm hoping, but eventually they're going to need something that's going to distinguish themselves to get people to sign up and use the system. Right.
Right.
Amazon paid. Was it Lady Gaga or?
No, it was Zynga.
Zynga paid. No,
no, no. Both of them.
Both of them.
Actually,
how
Amazon
much did they pay? How much did Amazon pay Lady
to
Gaga
to give it away
to get people there? And you know, I think they paid her $1, and you know, to the value of the customer was $5. So that's kind
and the
of
promotion was Zynga, to Kara's point.
Yeah.
Which was
well,
so
actually,
clever.
That Lady Gaga paid them.
That's where they're gonna. This is, I think, going to have to be, because as these things, and I don't believe it's going to stop, even though I do believe there's only a limited amount of time that people can spend on, you know, between video games, that these people are going to need content, and whatever we define the content as, and then hopefully we have a big enough platform of content that they need, or we can manufacture or come up with ideas for them to create content.
This goes back to some extent, it's identity as content,
right.
And everyone will recall, you know, Twitter was doing well, but it wasn't until Ashton started using it and developed that very clever competition with CNN, that Twitter experienced absolutely, you know, extraordinary growth.
Mm-hmm.
And you could say the same of, it's funny, Kara, when Google Plus first launched, you start thinking about how long it's going to take before a celebrity, and speaking of Lady Gaga, is Lady Gaga you too?
Yes.
God. So you can play that game. It should be a drinking game, by the way, where if someone can figure out talent you don't represent, I got to do a shot.
Yeah.
You wouldn't be drinking much. I think you'd be pretty safe. But Lady Gaga appeared with Marissa Myers on stage at Google, and they did an amazing job hosting her, by the way. I'm sure you saw that. The footage that they rolled out, you see the power of Google as a platform, and then you see what historically has been all about machine learning and algorithms become very human and very social. And it was all about the zeitgeist. You know, it's not going to take much to start to leverage that kind of celebrity and that kind of content. He's
Hallelujah.
into a platform like that, which has absolutely extraordinary scale. Google's
Except
reaching well over a billion
who
people.
Who pays who in those scenarios? That you get paid for bringing interest into it, correct? That you provide interest.
Listen, that's my conclusion. I might be wrong.
Right.
But we'll see.
Right. So that these
Listen, here's the great thing. With the audience, with Open Sky, a bunch of the stuff we're doing in our digital, we're making a bet that there's great platforms that exist, and our API will sit on top of it. We don't have to recreate Facebook or Google Plus or we don't have to. All we have to do is make sure that what we're creating kind of can sit on top of them and utilize the platforms to the advantage of our clients and hopefully for the platforms.
So what works best now for you from Hollywood's perspective? What is important to Hollywood at this moment of these platforms?
I think for the first time we're all learning about kind of how to utilize them, right? I don't think there's a lot of guys that program them well, right? So I think Demand Media did their version with Google, right? I think Disney did a pretty good job at, they went from, 395,000 page views on Facebook to, I think they're up to right now 194 million, mm-hmm. right? There's not a lot of people that program these things well. I think we're in business with a couple different groups that do that well. We'll see. That's our big bet. That's one of our big initiatives. Sean Parker said to me, he goes, just do as many things you can in the social space with your clients because they hit more than anybody else on those and monetize that relationship at every point.
Right.
That's what we're trying to do.
So you're promiscuous in that regard.
We're trying, right?
Right, so you'll do anything.
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Almost anything. Yeah.
What hasn't worked? Because Hollywood's been trying various things to get into
only been at it for 2 years, so right. We haven't, fucked
up. In the social space.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So.
What else is important when you think about talent in the digital space for you? What is Apple a critical partner for you?
Amazon? In our music space and our book space, we have a book business right now that for the first year was performing, it was okay. Now actually for the first time because of the ebook, it's actually starting to ramp in a really good way. Mm-hmm. So we're thinking about, do we take a big swing at the plate here and figure out what to do? We'll utilize all of our relationships and call on people and say to think about, because we're the largest literary agency in the world. I think we publish 225 bestsellers a year, and we have a 100-year-old backlist. What we do with that? Maybe it's nothing for a little bit. Maybe it's something. That's kind of the next initiative of where we're going to try and play.
You kind of don't have a choice. Didn't Borders announce today they're closing down all their stores?
Yeah. So we're going to figure out over the next little bit of time how we can get into that space in a different way potentially, or partner in a different way. Mm-hmm. We don't have the answer yet. We're just starting to think about it.
Do you imagine doing a LinkedIn
No, he keeps on rejecting me and not wanting to pay for anything.
Okay.
No.
It's
that's a joke.
It's freemium. It's freemium. You'll have a lot of people
Listen, we do have a lot of business authors.
Right.
So they're definitely, one of the things we were talking about besides this premium and kind of this, we were talking about a lecture series, so we were talking about trying to do a lecture series together with LinkedIn and trying to figure that out and about leadership and about business opportunities for their members and bringing things to that organization that actually they don't have right now.
So is that, Jeff, is that really good for him or is it just good for LinkedIn? Just the way, content has been very good for Google and not necessarily for the content owners. Kind of thing. Google's gotten a mass of the benefit from being able to index and sell back information about the content. Is this a good relationship for you more than them? If you're being honest, it's great for you to get all these authors.
You can lie. I don't mind.
It really goes back to what we're talking about earlier. It's going to come down to the model. It's not a clear-cut case that because we have the distribution that these deals are going to happen. If they're not sustainable over time, and if more importantly the interests aren't aligned, then they're not going to happen. They're certainly not going to happen through legal mechanisms. If people start scraping or doing things, wearing a black hat and doing things that they're not supposed to be doing, violating the rights of intellectual property holders, you have a whole separate set of issues. But when you ask, is this going to be good for LinkedIn? Is it going to be good for Ari's clientele and the agency? Just picking up on the example he was providing, our membership would love access to videos of leaders and their discussions and how to inspire people and how to build great businesses and all the things that they've learned over time. So one of the things, I guess we're going to brainstorm with the audience, one of the things we were kicking around was essentially creating a TED for leadership,
yeah.
for business leadership. He's got a lot of the content. We have the audience and the platform. And something like that wouldn't just exist online. It would exist offline as well, where you mm-hmm. can start doing events and conferences, and we invite you to come moderate and conduct panels.
For free,
and,
right? Premium, Kara.
Well, we're helping to build your brand, Kara,
yeah,
when
you.
We do that. And so there's
how do you feel?
I just had one of the
I don't do anything I'm not paid
I just
for.
Had one of the scariest this. Moments in my career, having the two of you up on a panel ganging
right.
up against me would not be a good thing.
Ari and I always get paid.
Yeah, exactly. Listen, at the end of the day, I don't think any social platform.
And by the way, thank you for fee that you paid. Anyway, go ahead.
That's right, exactly. So if something's worth what somebody's willing to pay.
Also, you know, listen, to defend him a little bit, is, you know, they were at the early stage. They have a brand they have to build. They have certain things that they were doing and still have to do for a very early company. So over time, they're going to, first of all, what their audience is going to demand is going to change the offerings. You know, over time, it's going to adapt, and they're going to require different things, and their audience is going to require it. That's when you can play with these models in a different way. It's pretty early for them to,
right.
And you know, they. I think more valuable than anything is the brand of LinkedIn right now than anything else that could. Than anything else you would do would probably hurt the economics behind that. So, give them a little bit of a break.
All right.
Okay.
Jeff did advise me to put all of D for free on the web at one point, though. Yeah.
So, you know, at one point, I came in the last time we spoke. Can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure,
okay.
Please.
So,
this is why I had a moderator.
Yeah.
To avoid this.
You know, we were talking about the Huffington Post.
Yeah.
And how you started talking about at one spectrum was Yahoo.
Yeah.
Another spectrum was, I think you put Google at the other spectrum?
The search operating system, the social operating right. system, the media operating
and
system.
And then you said the next big company, and one of the companies you thought at the time they hadn't sold was the Huffington Post because they incorporated all the social aspects
yep.
and search,
yep.
or search modernization, I mm-hmm. should say, and that a company that could do that would be really, really valuable. So first, did you think that HuffPost was right to sell?
Mm.
And now that HuffPost is sold, who do you think is, if you still believe that, who do you think is that company out there that could, that kind of
fits
that
Who's the best position
yeah.
to, okay. Right. So for some context, great memory. So Ari and I were brainstorming a little bit about the future of digital media. I'm looking forward to hearing your thoughts on this, the two of you. But essentially, he was talking about a continuum that's existed for some time now, where on the one end of the continuum, you have a search engine like Google, which creates relevancy through search algorithms and machine learning at scale. And it historically was all about that. And then at the other end of the continuum, you have these social platforms. And when we were originally talking about this years ago before I met Ari, to tell you how dated this was, MySpace was the example, and of course today it's Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, et cetera. And for those companies, the organization of information was historically exclusively based on who you know.
No, right.
All of it was based on who you know. And then in the middle, this was while I was at Yahoo, we were thinking about this, in the middle was a company like Yahoo that programmed its homepage based on editors and curators. And at the time, it wasn't leveraging machine learning or relevancy and creating content optimization to figure out the best content to get in front of you at the right time. And it wasn't really leveraging its implicit social graph, which was its address book and instant messenger buddy lists. But it did do an incredible job of editing and trying to figure out what people wanted to see. And that's why the Yahoo homepage to this day has hundreds of millions of users every month. And Yahoo to this day has over 600 million unique users. And so what I was talking about with Ari was the fact that what I believe to be the leading digital media company of the 21st century was going to be able to integrate these three dimensions seamlessly and in a way that had never been done before. Because what's interesting is that historically, the way these companies grew and created value was through essentially a sole focus on that competency. And once you create a culture around a singular competency, it becomes very challenging to expand that. But yet, there's no question that media, digital media, once media becomes digital, it needs to be optimized through machine learning and algorithms.
Yeah.
It needs to be social to enjoy the kind of viral distribution that's possible now. And it needs to be curated because we're all becoming completely overwhelmed by all the information out there. And at the time, I was suggesting HuffPo was doing this. It's just a lot of people didn't realize that they had invested and built out this really wonderful infrastructure to optimize content. So you could literally, if you were on the HuffPo homepage long enough, you'd see the headline changing for the same story. Or you'd see the image changing for the same story. They were A-B testing.
Well, actually, other people's stories, but go ahead.
Okay. And so,
give me some skin there,
you're going high five again on that?
I love that.
And but they did a beautiful job.
They were amazing at it.
Better headline writers.
And then they were leveraging things like Facebook Connect and Twitter and LinkedIn within a professional context to enable that content to be shared and go viral. And of course, the great competency of HuffPo, no matter how critical some would be about where they get their content, their editors did an incredible job of figuring out what people want to read and when, and then creating the right headline. And that is a real art. And so the HuffPo was doing this, not at the same scale as, say, a Yahoo, but they were doing it, and they were doing it real well. And by the way, they've continued that torrid growth trajectory. I mean, they're still hitting all-time highs in terms of unique users. And I thought it was a very, very interesting play for Tim and for AOL.
So you thought it was good sale?
That was the buy, not the sale. So you're asking about the sale. I'd be interested, if I had a chance to sit down with Ariana, I'd ask her why she didn't think she could go it independently. Because of the momentum that was in the business. Now, that said, I think Tim will be the first to point out a lot of the growth since the acquisition is because they're so deeply integrating it into AOL's homepage.
Right.
So that was the plan the entire
time.
Plus,
he's giving her a blank check to do whatever she wants, and I don't believe her board was allowing her to do that.
That may be the case. That may be the answer.
So now, what company, if now the HuffPo's gone, is best positioned capture that vision?
It's a fantastic question. So I think, interestingly
enough, you think everybody wants to know?
All three companies that I would have used, or three segments, are all increasingly converging, which was, to some extent, one could predict. So Google is clearly becoming more social. When we had this discussion, Google Plus didn't exist. Google's clearly becoming more social. They've always had this extraordinary ability to deliver relevancy based on algorithms and machine learning. And what will be interesting is to see whether or not they start to do curation. And you could see some of the recent success of YouTube, which is another runaway success over time. YouTube's homepage is increasingly programmed.
Well, but they're now starting a bunch of channels, so they will start
how do you look at YouTube when they're starting to do that?
That's the huge push, because, you know, as search, you still have, you know, the economics, you know, display is actually growing as in importance for them, and I think also in economics for the advertisers, and I think that's why they're making their big push at YouTube plus what you're talking about.
How do you look at a YouTube when they're trying to do this? Because it's been a long time before.
Listen, we're going to try a couple with them.
Right. Taylor Lautner channel, obviously.
Of course.
Right.
We presented them with about four or five different ideas. There's a meeting going to be happening with us and them at the end of this month.
One idea?
I'm not going to do that.
It's definitely a Taylor Lautner chess channel.
Absolutely. And we'll then see, because we're going to try a couple with them and see.
Can you tell the nature? I'm just curious. Is it around brands or stars?
Like
you could have a Kristen.
Not gonna happen.
You could have a Kristen Stewart.
I promise
Stewart,
you, you're not getting this out of me.
But you listen to me. I have an idea. A Kristen Stewart pouting channel.
She's pitching.
Yeah.
She could do all her pouting.
You should stay in what you do and let the other part.
Really?
Will let me
pouting,
do it.
I would watch a Kristen Stewart pouting channel.
Not yourself. I think you should go pitch it.
Speaking of the future of YouTube, it will be interesting to see whether or not there's some discussion that Hulu's for sale, and I may have read this on your site, and then Google's rumored to be looking at it, Yahoo's rumored to be looking at it, and getting back to Ari's question, Yahoo is still very much in that mix. Yahoo has curation and editorial capabilities as a competency.
Been losing a little bit in their audience? Hasn't that been kind of?
It's still massive scale. You're still talking north of 600 million uniques.
Yeah.
And had historically in the search team people who understood how to optimize content. Mm-hmm. It was historically done for search, but easily could have been leveraged in content. And one thing that people don't talk about with regard to Yahoo, believe it or not, it's one of the fastest growing apps on Facebook. Mm-hmm. No one's talking about that, and I think that's very much by
design. Well, mostly because Yahoo doesn't talk about it, but that's...
Well, you know, it's funny you mention that.
Funny
because,
I mentioned that.
Yeah, because I was talking about this earlier with somebody. Did you see right around the time of the royal wedding, Yahoo
did... They did a great job.
Actually, that was another story on your site. So they announced that they hired the managing editor from the HuffPo.
Right, Jay.
And that, that's right, Jay. And that was in the same release as the fact they'd achieved an all-time record in terms of live event coverage with the royal wedding. Prior to that, it was Osama bin Laden. Prior to that, it was the earthquake in Japan.
Right.
When Yahoo can stick to what it does best, original content, unique editorial voice, huge live events that nobody else can cover, that's still the place people turn on the internet for that shared communal experience of what's happening in the world at scale. They'll turn to Twitter for the microcasting of that to see what people are sharing. They'll turn to Facebook to see that in people's feeds.
You know, they remind me a little bit of, you know, when there's a big news event in television, you turn on CNN. Hmm. And you can tell when, you know, again, royal wedding, big news event, something, boom, you hit CNN. And then after that event's over, you move on. Same thing with Yahoo. Now, they do still have 600 million people, unlike CNN. But they haven't then past that been able to keep that momentum, even though they still have a lot of people, and they do have great curation and everything else. So is it Zynga that goes in there that then gives them another form? I mean, what happens with that company?
Oh, excellent question. Thank you, Ari.
No problem, honey.
So,
I've read a lot of your stuff, so I
really?
Know.
Really? Oh, good. I'm saying you just read two of my stories.
I wrote
a story today saying Yahoo had to buy Hulu.
I'm buttering her up.
Yahoo had to buy
you
Hulu?
You have to butter her up a little bit more.
Yeah. I could learn. I'm learning from the master real time in front of everybody.
Okay.
You said Yahoo had to buy Hulu.
Today I wrote a story saying they have to buy Hulu.
And the rationale.
Must get it. Because that's what they do. I think I agreed with you. I think they're spending all their time pretending they're competing with Google, which is laughable. Because it just is, and they should be. There's nobody in the media space as good as they had been, and so they spend their time stubbing their toe and driving themselves into a wall on a daily basis on things they're going to fail at. So, and I said, this is something they're good at, and they refuse to engage in it, which is fascinating.
And you don't think after Zynga goes public, Zynga, then them,
what,
and Yahoo get together, and he kind of, no.
No.
Okay.
Okay, but okay, sure, why not? But what I'm asking, the idea of what he's talking about is that what happens to media distribution going forward? I mean, how do you look at, you must be thinking about this because you don't want to just be all in social networks. Do you see that the only way of you getting,
No. I mean, we're hopefully going to do 3, 4, 5, 6 different channels with them.
With Yahoo.
Yeah. We're doing stuff in social. We're doing stuff in games. In the social gaming area, we're doing stuff in shopping online and stuff like that. So we're in multiple different places. We're going to take multiple different shots. I just was wondering this because when you think about it, you know, what's that best company out there? And it could be Google because now with Google Plus.
Could be Google. Could be Yahoo. Finish the continuum. And Facebook, it was recently, this wasn't also on your blog, was it? Facebook is going to be doing news. They're working with a bunch of news partners. Yeah. They've been very explicit about the fact that they believe social can transform various industries, and one that they're keenly interested in is media and entertainment, and certainly music is something that they're going to be delivering more of. They've been delivering filmed entertainment now, and I think you're going to start to see a lot more of that. So as Facebook starts to think about certainly categorization at the very least, I'm not going to go as far as saying curation, but if they were to go that path and start thinking about curation editorial, how you aggregate the best experiences, they've clearly got the largest social graph. And there's a lot of optimization that takes place behind the scenes on Facebook. You know, your feed, Facebook, companies like LinkedIn, Twitter, ultimately, we're trying to create as much relevancy as possible through machine learning. So there's this convergence taking place.
So what is, in that question, and then we'll get to some questions from the audience, what is Hollywood in 5 years, and what is the social networks in 5 years? What do you see it being?
Well, I think there's still going to be. I think there's still going to be movies, television, music, and books.
And you're going to insist on putting everything in 3D, right?
No, and that will be what it will be, and there'll be more distribution than there's ever been, right? And the economics are tough in the movie business right now. The television business is actually very good. The music touring business, very. I actually think the music business of selling music is going to get better.
Well, it couldn't get worse.
Right, or stabilize, I should say. And the book business will be fine. But I do think there'll be, we're going to have to migrate into more social games, more kind of understanding how to program in these other platforms and what the definition of that programming means. And we're going to have to get better at it if we're going to survive, because there's only a limited pool.
So what company are you most interested in cozying up to?
That's a good question.
I'm not interested in cozying up to any company.
If you could only pick one company,
yeah.
you have a. Now it's my turn.
Good. That was the follow.
So here we go. Here we go. This is fun playing Ari. Okay. So you're scheduling a trip up to Silicon Valley, and you have an all day. You're going to meet with all these companies we've been talking about, and it turns out one of your most important clients says, Ari, we got something we need to work on. Please come back as soon as possible. You're like, okay. So you only have time for one meeting.
What's your most important?
Who do you take that meeting with?
You.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Come on. His parents are here. What do you think I'm going to do?
You can include Amazon and Netflix.
Yeah, we've been spending a lot of time on the social platforms. Right. We start talking about portals. You have these digital distribution players, the Amazon,
the Apples,
the Netflix.
Who are you doing the meeting with?
It will probably be Facebook.
And Hollywood,
there
where
you
do
go.
You go?
Oh, seriously?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's easy.
Okay. All right.
Thank God.
Thank God. All right.
His parents are in the audience.
I really want to meet your parents. Questions from the audience. Right back there, right here. Next. Oh, okay. Well, there isn't one yet. First question. Go ahead.
Hey, how's it going? I'm Dean. This one's for Ari. What's the best advice you've ever received about the industry that you've carried forth in all that you've done?
When I was an assistant for this very old agent in New York by the name of Robbie Lance, and at the time I was making copies of Amadeus, and like a schmuck, I didn't, you know, they're all the notes from Milos Forman and Peter Schaffer, and I didn't copy them, and I was this. And he was a really great, he started me in the business, and he said to me, you know, the only way you get your phone calls returned is that you have to represent really great people. Everything else doesn't matter. And for my specific business, you know, that is a very crucial. And then David Geffen said to me, something which I've never forgotten, just make sure you stay in traffic, because if you stay in traffic long enough and you have enough business, you're going to get hit and something great's going to happen. And the third thing is...
you mean physically hit with a car?
Yeah,
okay. Exactly.
Which has happened to me.
Okay, okay. This shocks me.
I don't remember who said it, but I think... Now, more than ever, great ideas or great voices are more important than ever, because they distinguish in this kind of spread. And, you know, those three things are the kind of things that I think about a lot.
So you're talking about talent.
Just
really
being able,
great,
you know,
people, great talent.
You know, it used to be said in the music business you have to have great ears. Right, because then you can know a great song, or, you know, for whatever reason, I've had the opportunity, and I can identify great writers, and I think I can identify something that a lot of people kind of, for whatever, when I see it, I can say, you know, something that's something that's interesting to a lot of people. That's going to become more important than ever. So those three things are things that I kind of have enabled me to become, I think, successful, and I think about a lot. So.
You're showing about quality.
Yeah.
Stick with quality.
Yeah. Or what you perceive to be quality. Yeah.
Two quick thoughts just following up on actually Ari's response. One is the third thing that Ari mentioned, Thomas Friedman would characterize as saying imagination is the only thing that can't be commoditized. And increasingly that will drive the global economy. But it's funny when you asked about the best advice he received in terms of Hollywood, because the best advice I received with regard to my career was while I was in Hollywood, and it was about the convergence of technology and entertainment or media, and it was the book Being Digital by Nicholas Negroponte. And in the very beginning of the book, he wrote a line that changed my life. So I joined Warner Brothers Corporate Development Department in September of 1994.
What was the line?
And it was that everything that can be converted from an atom to a bit will be. And that was before the web had really become mainstream. I had just started in the corp dev group. I was the youngest person. I was the only analyst in the group. And the guy who had created the corporate development division believed that Warner Brothers needed an interactive department, and that would be divided between Warner Brothers Online, CD-ROMs, which was the big one, and out-of-home interactive entertainment. And I had just gone on and gotten my first AOL account a few months prior to that, so I volunteered after reading this book to help out with the online portion that was kind of an afterthought. And so wrote the business plan for Warner Brothers Online in December of 1994.
Wow.
As a result of that line in that book.
God, I covered that. I'm going to give mine for my grandparents. One was my grandfather used to always say, it's a similar thing to what he's saying. My grandfather used to always say, intelligence has its limitations, but stupidity is infinite. And the second one was from my grandmother, who when I wouldn't visit her selling, I was a very, very busy person down at the Washington Post. She said, the graveyards are full of indispensable people. So I always remembered that. Next question, right here.
I guess this is kind of leveraged off your point that you can't encode taste. In both your cases,
you can I use that line? I'm
sure.
Going to use that line.
Thanks.
I like that line.
Yeah. In both your cases, you kind of make a living by trying to figure out what's going to happen next. You know, either in how you organize a company or how you spot a talent. Not a major talent, but who's coming up. You know, what's going to be good down the road? What do you and in your case, you know, both organizing a company strategically and inside LinkedIn, figuring out where the job's going to come from, what do you think you could teach each other about that?
About trend spotting?
About trend spotting, figuring out what's coming next, mm-hmm. how to spot an obscure talent that's going to be great. What do you see and do that you'd tell him and vice versa?
Well, you know, the funny thing is, I always wonder because up in Silicon Valley, you know, they have put into algorithms human nature, or they attempt
Data.
Constantly put into algorithms how we act. And I was always wondering whether you could identify or predict talent through something.
You know, data.
Something. Yeah. And I don't know if you could predict Larry David. You know, I just, right? I don't think you can do it. Yeah, I don't think you could do that either. But I do think that what they do better than we do is the thought process between less people touching something, right? We actually need more people. You know, we need more people touching it because we believe that there's more ideas when people get into a room and start thinking about creatively what needs to happen. I question that at times because in our business, there's this phrase called the green light committees in the movie business, right? And I've never known anything that comes out of anything great that comes out of a committee. But I do think that we have to kind of get better at less people touching stuff and figuring out how to communicate better with not just being in groups. And we probably could learn that through being up here more.
But you're talking about instinct versus...
Yeah. You know, when we go into a meeting and we're talking about a movie or we're talking about a TV show and we're talking about what writers should do it, what directors should do it, you know, there's a lot of swirl that goes on, and then you come up with this idea. And it happens at the agencies, and it happens at the movie companies, or the studios, record companies, book. And maybe less would be more in that situation, which I think, at least I believe that happens up here, right? And I think we probably could learn from that a little bit more, kind of using data better. We don't use it very well, I don't think, down in...
Meaning you can't.
We don't organize it that way. We're not organized that way.
Could you predict a hit from data? Probably not. Snakes on a plane, for example.
I don't know if you could, but the problem is we're not organized in that thought process
right.
To even
extract the right data to even be able to analyze it, see if you could do it. And I think we're trying to get better at it. Maybe some people have done it. But I think that's where we could probably use what he does.
So I had a three-part answer. And to give you an indication of why Ari is as successful as he is, the last part of his answer was the first part of my answer, which was data and the use of data. And whereas he said you couldn't have discovered Larry David using an algorithm, you certainly could have tracked his initial resonance with an audience leveraging data. And he's all over it. There is an infrastructure that exists now. There is more real-time data available, extraordinarily valuable data available to us than at any time in human history. And it's just a question of how you make use of it. And making sure, and this is the second part of the answer, making sure you have the right talent. And with regard to data and understanding the data and understanding the insights and the predictive analysis, it's about data scientists who have become, at least in Silicon Valley, the new search engineer. There's an awful lot of demand for data scientists. There's not a lot of supply. And so
they are mainly mathematicians.
Math and statistics, and in this day and age, computer science, and a whole range of skills. And by the way, that's the science of it. There's also an art to it, which is, like anything else in life, having a gut and being able to know where to look and how to make connections, cross-disciplinary connections, and a whole host of other dimensions.
Let me throw something out. We interviewed Steve Levitan at DU the year before last, and he was talking about how he uses Twitter. He was saying most of this stuff is useless to him as a creator of a huge hit television show that remains a hit television show. And he said the way he uses Twitter, for example, is he watches how the jokes work. They watch it while the show is on, and then they know what jokes work with people. And that's how they use it. And it's not in anything. He said he wouldn't change anything based on
I'm not actually talking about that. But there is so much information and now and, you know, comics going up on YouTube and our ability to track it and understand the data, we don't yet do a very good job of it.
Or you could get the wrong information.
We just don't. We're not compiling it properly, or we're not looking at it properly. You know, we're still looking at Nielsen ratings. I mean, you know, 3-day and 7-day. I mean, it's just insanity. I mean, Nielsen.
That's part of what a great data scientist does, or anyone who's utilizing the data is able to filter out the signal from the noise, and you'll get a false positive, false negative, and you can go down a huge rat hole trying to pursue that insight or what's going on, and the best will say that's not worth pursuing. So certainly the way in which we leverage data and the infrastructures to support how we can leverage data, the talent to do it, and that's the second part to the answer, which is the talent. And that's where we started tonight's discussion. Mm-hmm. And it's a little bit different in Silicon Valley and Hollywood. But at the end of the day, it's about talent. And so I know that I'm only as good as the talent that I've surrounded myself with. And very thankfully, we've been able to build a truly world-class team at LinkedIn. And it's something I've learned over the years in terms of the talent I look for in Silicon Valley. You know, in baseball, there's the five-tool player. And I've kind of constructed a similar analog in tech circles and what we do, which is five tools that you look for. And you don't have to find someone who's got all five. If someone's really good at any one of these things, it's valuable. That's how you build a team. But if you can start to cobble together people who have skills on multiple dimensions across these five, you're in a really good position. It's technology vision, the ability to understand where the world is moving going forward and how technology will ultimately enable that vision to manifest. It's about product sensibility, so you understand where the unmet needs are in a marketplace, in society, and you can actually manifest that technology in ways that create value. It's about business acumen, because you could build the world's greatest product, and if it doesn't have a sustainable business model, it's not going to get you very far. It's about the ability to evangelize and inspire others to come follow you, because oftentimes your vision of the way the world will evolve is going to fight conventional wisdom, and you're going to need to spend a lot of time and energy convincing others to follow you. And then fifth, and perhaps most important, is resourcefulness. Because no matter how good an evangelist you are, you may at times be unable to convince people that your way is the right way. And so you have to be prepared to roll up your sleeves and just get it done.
I thought you were going to say luck, but over here.
I have a question for Jeff. Jeff, you have a new initiative going for nonprofits. Can you tell me how that started and where you hope it goes?
Sure. So I'm not sure if this is what you're referring to specifically, but we've got a couple of things in the works. One, and I think the most basic and perhaps the most powerful, is just adding a volunteer field to the LinkedIn profile. And this hasn't rolled out broadly yet, but it's something that we're starting to phase in. And we were talking earlier about identity and professional brands, and a huge part of one's professional identity, at least a lot of the people I have the privilege of working with, is how they give back and how they make a difference and how they leverage their skills and their experiences to give back to their communities. And I think this goes back to being a platform. We're increasingly in a position where we can help connect people with the right skills and, more importantly, the interest in making a difference and giving back with the right philanthropic entity or the right philanthropic initiative or the right individual, underprivileged individual who would never have access to the right mentorship to be able to become an entrepreneur. And so we're in the process longer term of building out a marketplace to connect our professional membership with those philanthropic opportunities. And that begins with something as simple as indicating on your profile the kind of volunteer work you want to do by industry segment, the kind of volunteer work you've already done. Because when somebody else visits your profile and they see what you're doing, they may be inspired to do the same. And at the click of a button, they can get involved themselves.
Interesting. Next question, right here.
Ari, is what Netflix is doing with some of their algorithms the kind of stuff that would be useful to people in Hollywood trying to make decisions about television and movie programming?
You know, I think the algorithms that Apple is doing or Amazon's doing to tell you what else you would like are all great, but they're great for them. What I'm talking about is, MGM has got X amount of movies in their library, thousands of movies in their library. They don't know which movies should be remade, right, if they're going to remake a movie. We have no idea what movies are going to work and not work and why we're doing them. You know, we do them now based on what we think the international value is of a movie star or X, Y, Z. We have not kind of cultivated what the audience wants and why they want it at all. We've not not that that's going to, most data is going to give you a guide. It's not going to give you the answer. We have not done any of that, and that's where I'm talking about, kind of beforehand, not after we've made it. And I think that's the problem with it's a problem.
Right.
That's where we need to get better at, I think. And there is just general instinct to it. And if you could put it in an equation, then everybody would do it. But I think that's where we could and may be able to get better, and that's where probably, Northern California could help us.
So
the algorithms that they're doing are really kind of data mining for what else you would like to upsell you some other stuff. That's just like direct marketing with a little bit of
Do you imagine being able to make the perfect movie before? Like this will
no,
be
No, no, no. All I'm saying is the following. one of the things that we do now is we do remakes, right? And
a lot.
Why we do remakes is so subjective to that head of a studio or that head of a network.
You just go Gilligan's Island.
Yeah,
it's
got to
come
why,
back, right?
Right?
Which it is, by the way.
So I think there's probably there might be a better way to do that.
Right.
We're still using Nielsen.
Right. How would you characterize
in this day and age? It's insanity.
Why do you characterize how you make decisions like that? It's just spray and pray kind of thing?
Yeah. There's a lot of spray and pray. Now,
but you're also leveraging information. You're leveraging expertise. At the end of the day, though, when you said it's a problem and then you corrected yourself, I was going to say that's the magic. That's the art and the science, and it works in both directions.
I agree, but I'm not even sure there is an answer to this, right? But I would like to know, I'd like to go through a more rigorous process.
Yeah.
And maybe we come out the other end and we say, hey, it's all instinct.
Well, okay. At the very least, though, it can help cull down the opportunities,
correct,
right, and filter some of the things. But we were talking about this before we came on stage tonight. We were just catching up on pop culture, and we were talking a little bit about The Voice. So the fact that The Voice was as successful as it was, the Voice is a singing competition, and there's some heads going up and down, but had you predicted the world needed another singing competition after American Idol and after...
X Factor's coming out.
You got X Factor coming out, and then you got the, what's the one with the Glee Clubs and the...
Glee Project.
The Project Glee, yeah.
Project.
Sing? I thought it's Sing or something like that. Yeah. At any rate, no one would have been able to predict the world needed yet another singing competition, but
it was
great. The magic of what happens and the magic of what Ari does and his team does and the people in Hollywood do, they bring people together in certain environments and they allow things to happen in a way that could never have been predicted. And in this particular case...
Although that was still a formula, crazy lady,
it may
mean
have started,
man.
It may have started as a formula, but the
you
thing
would
you
never
could have predicted,
predicted
the emotional resonance between the judges and the kids who are singing. And
incredible.
We were talking a little bit about that. I mean, unless the lead singer from Maroon 5 is just an absolute brilliant actor as well as being a brilliant singer, he very clearly became attached and moved and inspired by the kids that he was mentoring. And the same was true for all of the judges. Mm-hmm. That's the part that no algorithm could ever in a million years predict. The judges of that show could never have predicted and get that attached in light of their lives and their celebrity. And that's the magic of what Ari does. It's the magic of Hollywood.
So essentially you're saying they don't know what's going to happen. They just put it up there.
They do, but Mark Burnett,
somebody,
the producer.
Mark Burnett, you know, he's an incredible producer, did an amazing job on that show, right? That he figured out the formula that he thought would get to this emotional resonance at the end. Who
which
knew?
Was instinct, which was what you're talking
about. Yeah, this what he does for a living.
Right, right. Jeremy?
Yeah, one of the nice things about LinkedIn is just the transparency of professional talent all around the world. And I'm just wondering about the Hollywood talent business. When is it going to become more transparent? Ari, you're not on LinkedIn. And I think your firm and the other...
Tell them, man. Tell them to get on there, please.
I'm not getting killed by all you people.
Your firm and the other Hollywood talent firms, your websites have less information than the CIA website.
Okay.
Just wondering, when are you going to become more transparent?
Yeah. Why?
Why wouldn't you want people to know about your company and your talent? And
why? Why do I need to have that happen? Is that important to you?
Sure.
I'm not trying to attack you.
He wants to know what he gets out.
What do I get out of it? That you have to know who I represent and what is the big deal? You think if something good could come out of it, which we are actually, I'm actually doing a bunch. But what would you want to see, learn, know about?
Everything.
Why?
Because people want.
What would you
access
want? In all bullshit. What would you want?
Who do you represent?
Why? Why?
He just wants to know.
Why? No, I'm serious. What do you care as long as you get to see Curb Your Enthusiasm, as long as you get to see Aaron Sorkin's next show, as long as... What do you care? What do you care? I don't need your influence.
Right. You know
I've
what?
Got my
let
mother.
Let me just.
I don't need anybody.
Let me
like
just. I think.
No, I don't.
I think he's saying. I think he's saying in a very nice way.
You don't get the right to have mine. I don't need to give you. I don't want it. I'm not asking you for your information. Stop asking for mine. Stop asking. You. Okay.
Okay.
I followed up.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, just one sec. I think what he's saying is he doesn't want to share his information with you.
But I don't know why I have to. Not everything should be shared.
Or perhaps anything.
No, if somebody wants to share their life, their information, go with God. I don't have to. It's not required that I have to do that. So I'm not going to fucking do it.
Okay. Translation, Ari does not care what the fuck you think.
No, I do, so, but I don't know why. You haven't told me there's some great reason.
You know why? You're endlessly fascinating. We can't get enough of you.
No, it's not about me. They want to know about my clients. It's not...
It's you, though.
No.
They want to know about you.
No.
You're like Bieber, but you're withholding, and Bieber gives everything.
Yeah, everything.
Anyway.
You think I should... I mean...
I was thinking about part of the conversation we had.
I don't think we could take you sharing, frankly. let's get to another question.
Hi.
Jeff is willing to tell you anything, by the way.
Yeah,
please. I think I just saw an episode from Entourage with Ari just now. This is a question for both Ari and for Jeff. You deal with talent on two different levels. What advice would you give to a person who is trying to, who has talent, who has the skills, but is trying to reinvent themselves?
Jeff?
Yeah, I'd say start with, I mean, you already established a key condition to, in my opinion, ultimately realizing your objectives or your career path, and that's the skills. I say ultimately you need two things to be successful, and one is skill and the other is passion. And I think oftentimes people will optimize for one or the other. You can optimize for skill and be pretty unhappy. You know, you hear all the time about people who are earning big incomes, but they're doing something that they don't love at all. Conversely, you could have people chasing windmills. They love something in particular, but they don't have the core skill set. So for someone that's got the skills, but they want to reinvent themselves, I guess my first question would be, what exactly are they reinventing? If they have the skills, are they going down a path that they weren't comfortable with for some reason? Have they lost the passion for what they're doing? Do they want to cultivate different skills in areas that they're passionate about? If you stick to those two things, if you stick to what you're passionate about and what you're skilled at, I think ultimately the doors start to open. And I think things manifest in ways implicit and explicit. I also think, by the way, in this day and age, and I'm not saying this just because I work at LinkedIn, but I think ultimately leveraging your network, your connections, becomes absolutely fundamental to getting your foot in the door, whether that's a company that ultimately you want to work for, whether or not that's a piece of information or knowledge that you need and can benefit from. I think trying to go it alone in this day and age is virtually impossible, given how interdependent and networked and global the world has become. So I'd start there. Optimize for skills, optimize for passions, and make sure that you are surrounding yourself with the right people.
In our case is, you know, when a client has a desire to kind of move into another area, you know, it's just how we kind of get them there and all the learning we give them. So if a client wants to be from a writer to become a director, or from a motion picture writer become a television writer, from or just a general writer become an author, it's just how we move them and how we introduce them to those things. Ask any question you want, sir. Knock yourself out. No, no, please ask, because you were interrupting him. Why don't you just ask your question? What would you like to ask?
My question is this. The program for the future collective intelligence about 3 or 4 years ago, Andy Van Dam and Alan Kay, you guys know who these guys are? Mm-hmm. They're at, were asked a simple question by Joel Gore. And I want the same question after you guys, but in different contexts.
So the question, Jesus Christ.
All right, ask the question.
Excuse
Please,
me.
I want you to ask the question. Go ahead.
I got to formulate it.
I understand Thank that, you. But there's lots of people who want to ask questions, so just ask it.
The question is this. In the context of you guys, in that context, it was Doug Engelbart. What has been accomplished and what remains to be done? Thank you.
What hasn't been accomplished and what has been accomplished and what remains to be done?
In what context?
Just broadly speaking. That's the it's like a I think it's like a Rorschach test.
A lot. Next question.
So wait. I'll take a stab at it. So, what has been accomplished is we have built infrastructure that connects hundreds of millions of people, will ultimately connect billions of people around the world in milliseconds. And the cost of building those connections, the cost of building those networks and those relationships, the cost of managing those relationships is next to nothing. And so as a result, we're all far more connected than we've ever been. So that's what we have accomplished, briefly. And what still remains to be done is to create far more compassion in the world as a result of those connections.
You're the man. Now I follow.
No, that's it. We've got to go to somebody else. But thank you for the question.
Hi. Actually, I want to go back to this gentleman's question because I got excited quite a bit. So I'm trying to look for synergy between entertainment and LinkedIn.
Yeah,
and I want to ask a specific question. So Mark Wahlberg. So are you right? I'm actually not that interested in seeing your profile on LinkedIn or your company's webpage. I'm more interested in Mark Wahlberg and, you know, other celebrities because I paid the money to watch their movies. So I'm curious to hear, Jeff, what is your value proposition to have people like Mark and other celebrities that Ari represents, to have them have profiles on LinkedIn and be present on LinkedIn?
Is that valuable to you, or is it more valuable?
Fantastic question. So the reason, all joking aside, that Ari's not on LinkedIn is something I hear from time to time from other people in his position, positions of great influence, positions of great success, and that is that LinkedIn can become asymmetrical. There are a lot more people that want things from Ari than Ari needs from those people. Ari is a shining example of what LinkedIn is all about. We want to empower people to become more like Ari in the best of ways. So everyone here, not necessarily dropping F-bombs or things like that, but everyone here knows who Ari is. His identity has been well established. That's not the case for the vast, vast majority of professionals in the world. Two, Ari probably has one of the all-time great Rolodexes, certainly in Hollywood. And if he needs something from somebody, he knows exactly where to find it. And that's three, the ability to tap and access information and knowledge that's going to help him to be more productive and successful. That last dimension is why he's Ari. He's got the knowledge, and if he doesn't have it in his head, he certainly knows the people that are going to be able to get it for him. So we're trying to empower everyone, all 640 million professionals in the world. There are 3.3 billion people in the global workforce. We're trying to empower every one of them to be more like Ari, or as
so
we say.
You want to create people who don't want to eventually share with anybody, correct?
No, we want to create economic opportunity.
Am I sharing? He was talking about my clients.
No, what Ari wants is for there to be reciprocal value, and he's actually been saying it the whole time, right? He's against freemium if there's no eum, if there's no premium in the freemium, right? So he'll use LinkedIn when LinkedIn can create as much value for him as he could create for the platform. And that's all we ask of anybody. So one quick way we do that for someone like Ari is connect him with other people similar to Ari, other CEOs, other people within the tech community that I think could create a lot of value
for him. Talking about benefits, obvious benefits.
It's symmetrical value versus asymmetrical value. For people like Mark Wahlberg, Mark's a really interesting choice because Mark has gone so far past being an actor. He's now an incredibly successful producer, probably had a great mentor, but he's now a really successful businessman. There's probably other people within the Hollywood community for whom that's still an objective. And so joining LinkedIn, building their networks, enables them to be more like Mark and more like Ari.
Or they could just tweet. Go ahead. Right.
So building on the previous question about career advice, one of the topics that was covered or highlighted in the program was aggressive career strategies. What are your thoughts on that, or what was it that you wanted to share with us, both Jeff and Ari?
Aggressive career?
Aggressive career strategies, I think, is what it said in the program.
A little something about that.
Well, you know, I have no idea what my mother fed me, or my brothers, listen, here's the only thing I would say to you. I love what I do. I wake up every morning. I go to sleep every night. I think about it in every part of my relationships, right? And I still love the movie business. I love books. I love going to theater. I love what we do. And I think the great thing about what we do right now is that it's ever expanding, right? Because of this relationship, I would have never had relationship with Facebook or Google, and kind of, it's endless. And the other thing is, it's every time I go into either creating a movie or a TV show, it's like starting a business. And I love that about it. And I also love the ability to use this business for social good. The only reason I am aggressive is because I believe my clients and I love what they stand for and what they're saying. I think if I wasn't in this business, I'm not sure I would be as aggressive. I don't think I would not be aggressive, but not to the drive that I am in this business. So I've been an agent now for 22 years. I never thought I would be this long, right? And to be candid, I think it's only getting better because of everything that we're talking about right now and all the different platforms and distribution and in all the right ways, as much as I kind of the bravado of saying, I'll have a lot of leverage. Because I love that my clients are saying something that's important. So for me, the reason I'm aggressive is because I still love it. And I still love every aspect of it, and I still love learning from it. So I think the most important thing is that you've got to go in, this is what I tell my three boys, you got to go into, and it's what my father said to me, my mother said to me, you got to go into something that you love. And I think that's the same thing for my brothers. My brother Ram loves politics and every aspect of politics, and my brother Zeke loves medicine and every aspect about medicine. And I think it's shown by their success. And he'll talk about why he's aggressive in what he does. But I think it has to start with something that you love and you care about and you want to do well in.
I think short answer is it really starts with ultimately knowing what it is you want to accomplish. And it's against that objective that you start to direct the passion and the skill that both Ari and I have been talking about tonight. And it's always surprising to me when you sit down with somebody and ask them what it is they ultimately want to accomplish, how often somebody won't be able to answer the question because they've gone down a path in life that's become far more opportunistic than they may have ultimately anticipated. They get a promotion here, someone offers them more money over there, and pretty soon they're doing something that wasn't necessarily part of the game plan, but it is what it is. And so for me, the best career strategy starts with that simple question, and it's a question I ask every single interview candidate that is interested in working at LinkedIn, which is ultimately, what is it you want to accomplish? What's the dream? And it starts there. And once you understand that and you identify the things you're most passionate about and the things you're best at, you'll be amazed at the extent to which it begins to manifest itself. And that's exactly what you were just describing. It's exactly what you were describing with your brothers, and it's exactly how my career has unfolded as well.
Very briefly, if either of you do something else, what would you do if it wasn't this? I know you have a dream to be a ballet dancer. What?
That was his family.
That's my brother.
His brother.
I've actually, something, because we started the merchant bank and now we're doing a digital and now we're doing, I kind of have the canvas that I want.
I've told my team this, they've heard it from me before. There's not a single other job I'd rather do in the world.
Really?
Interesting.
Used to be in my business, you'd start as an agent, you'd want to become head of a studio, you want to become head of a network. I've had those opportunities, don't want them.
Yeah, I saw that on the show. That was a great episode. So last question, very last question.
Gosh, last question. I'm glad
you didn't take the job.
Hi, so my question is about innovation. So LinkedIn Labs is an incubator, and you focus on the data to influence understanding users and product development. So what's a really interesting data-driven project coming out of LinkedIn Labs that influences what you do corporate? And for Ari, how do you incubate?
You don't have to answer me a question.
It's a two-part question. How do you just, in general, incubate creativity and innovation through your employees and the companies?
Yeah, I'd love to hear how you innovate. So for us, a project, no, seriously, I think that's a cool question for him, how he innovates the industry. For LinkedIn, I can't unfortunately mention the things that we haven't launched yet. We want that to be a surprise. But I can point to a couple of things that we've been very excited about. And one was the visualization of your professional graph on LinkedIn. At the click of a button, we can actually render a graph of your network, who you're connected to. And it never ceases to amaze me how endlessly interesting and insightful the visualization of your network can be, the natural clustering that takes place, the ways in which those clusters are interconnected, your former colleagues, your current colleagues, the migration over time of people from one cluster to another. So that's proven to be really interesting. I think for the biggest reason of all is because of the power in the data. It's a visualization of what we've been talking about tonight in terms of how valuable data can be. It's one thing to say it, it's another thing to see it. And you're starting to see this pretty material proliferation of infographics on the web, and I think we've just scratched the surface. How we make data interesting and insightful and, most importantly, easy to consume. And along those lines, something that we've just now started to roll out, which I've mentioned in the past, I can mention
here. What tools do you use for that?
the data visualization. It's proprietary tools. Some of it was open source, and then we added a proprietary layer on top, and that comes back to world-class talent. Our data scientists came up with that, and it's brilliant stuff. The other example I'll give you in terms of leveraging data and a practical application, when I was at school, when I was at Wharton undergrad, Wharton had a wonderful career center. I'm sure it still does. And to start to apply for jobs, you went down, you trekked down to the career center, you busted out this three-ring binder that was this thick, that had like coffee stains and it was ripped up. Sorry, Wharton, it's true. And you start thumbing through that to look for the kinds of companies you'd be interested in potentially working for. Then you go back up to your room, you'd pick a stock piece of paper, you'd create a resume, you'd get all of your closest friends to edit the resume, then you'd go back to the career center and you'd drop it into slots of the companies you were interested in working for, and then you'd wait for them to get back to you. Wharton undergrad would post a list of the interview schedule. You may be on it, you may not be on it. You interview and hopefully get a job. Today, we've got tools that will enable you to go online onto LinkedIn, and you will be able to see the career path of every alumni that went to your school by year of graduation, where they currently are, what companies they worked for, how they got there, what they studied, and how you're connected to them. So at the click of a button, you can get your foot in the door in those companies, you can connect with a new mentor, and then ultimately, we want to enable you to click one button and apply for the job without ever having to touch a piece of paper. So stay tuned for things like that.
We don't do anything like that. I mean, shit, that
sounds good. He goes to lunch at the Polo Lounge.
That sounds good.
you go to lunch, then you run into Mark Wahlberg, and then you go to the show, right?
I talked about some of the stuff we're doing in the digital side, but you know, really what we're doing right now is most of our stuff comes from the assistants in a weird way for all the new ideas that we're looking for. So once a month, and there's a bunch of other stuff to do, but once a month, and we started this in the book area, they run the meeting. They talk about all the interesting things out there and all the things that are happening that kind of none of us old-time fogies would know about. And now that's happening throughout the company. And there's a bunch of other stuff that we're doing. But I don't like to share information. So so that's one thing that we're doing that's actually been very, very helpful. Kind of one, it's gotten us talent. Two, it's shown us sites and people that we've taken from the web, and we've sold books with them. We've sold TV shows. So those are some of the things we're doing.
Have you had one successful, really, you consider successful television show from the internet or movie? Or?
Well, we sold, what was that one about the family photos? We sold that as a book, and now we're selling it as a reality show. So.
But anything big that you've seen yet?
I think that's pretty big. What's your definition?
No, it's huge. I don't know.
No. no, not yet.
The one about the blue people. The one that News Corp has. I'm totally blanking. Titanic, that's a big one.
No.
Something like that.
No.
Nothing yet.
No.
Okay, great.
Everybody, thank you, everybody.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We're losing control. On behalf of the Churchill Club and our audience, Ari, Jeff, and Kara, thanks so much for spending our evening with us. This has been memorable and inspiring, and I just want to clarify, we've not paid anyone or hacked any phones tonight. Thanks again to Hill and Knowlton and the Wharton School, University of Pennsylvania in San Francisco for their support, and thank you very much for being a great audience. Drive safely. Good night. Thank you.
Thank you.